When it turned and looked me in the eye, I thought I was gonna die right there. Dear Nance, this is something that happened a long time ago, and I've thought about it many times since it's happened, and I'm now ready to share it. At the time, I was living with my boyfriend in Seymour, Tennessee. This was the 1990s. He had a mobile home trailer that set back from the road at the base of a sloped hill. Behind us was all woods that went up and over a hill ridge. Me, I came from a farming community in Indiana. We did not have woods like that where I grew up. We did not have animals like bears or wild cats around us. So it was all very different from me and from what I knew in Indiana. And from day one, I was unnerved about the wild woods behind us. But my boyfriend assured me it was fine, and he took great pains to teach me how to be safe out there, what things meant, and how to hunt. But I was never at ease with those woods, no matter how hard he tried to help. From day one, there was something up there all the time, and it weighed on my mind. Sometimes I would be washing dishes, and I could swear that I just saw something moving out there on the hill. I would stop and I would look, but there was nothing to see. Sometimes when he was on night shifts, I would wake up from hearing something out there. Funny thing was, I knew something had awakened me, but I didn't know or couldn't remember what it was. But it unsettled me. I would tell him, and he would just brush it all off, or he would find 1,000 reasonable explanations for all of it. So much so, I began to believe him. I believed that I was just a jumpy girl from Indiana, not used to the great dark woods. That was all that was wrong. We used to go up and over the hill quite a bit, and I did try hard to enjoy it because it was beautiful. But I always felt odd when we went out there. I was never relaxed. This one day, we had gone up the hill just for something to do since it was such a nice day. We were picking up wood pieces to have a fire in the fire pit out back that night. And we were surprised to find a row of young trees. They were all bent and they were broken about 5 feet high, all of them. I remember counting over 12. They were all fresh, and the weird thing was, they didn't look like someone had snapped them, not exactly. They looked like they were twisted and torn, and all of them were twisted and twirled in the same direction. I asked him, "How did this happen?" He thought for a minute, then he said he didn't know. He'd never seen anything like that before. I told him that many times I felt like we were being watched out there. He stopped and he looked at me. Then he looked around for a bit, and he agreed that something felt off that day, and there weren't the normal birds and critters around. He was thinking that maybe there were trespassers out there that had spooked them off earlier in the day, and they left when they heard us coming. We looked around, but we didn't see anyone or anything. So we finished up collecting our firewood, carried it on down the hill, and went on with our day. Evening comes, and we're sitting out back. It's almost dark, and we had lit a fire in the fire pit. We were just sitting in chairs and talking. Then all of a sudden he stops right in the middle of what he was saying. I asked him, "What?" He shushed me and held up his hand. He was listening to something out there in the darkness. A few things I learned when I moved to Tennessee to be with him. You do not go out at night without a gun of some kind, not out there in the woods anyway. There are animals that will just wander right up to you, even if you're sitting near your house. And you should always take some kind of light with you so you can see what kind of animal it is. For my boyfriend, that light was one of those big handheld spotlights that has a big blocky battery. They're big and they're heavy, but it was very powerful. I couldn't begin to count the times for you that we would sit out there. He would hear something, and he would light it up. And it might be deer or stray dogs or sometimes just a raccoon. There were all kinds of things out there. It was just fun to know what we were seeing out there. So there he was. He's listening to something out there. And he reaches up under his chair and he gets out that spotlight. He starts panning all the trees going up to the hill there. We don't see anything. So he shuts it off. We shrug and we go back to talking after a minute or two. Then we hear a clear whooshing sound, then a loud metallic thunk. Something flew right past us in the darkness, and it hit the side of the trailer right behind us. It was metal, the trailer was, so it was loud. He lights up the trees again immediately with that spotlight. He's up out of his chair looking. We both are, and we don't see anything. We get up, and we go check to see what it was that hit the trailer. Maybe a bird flew into it or something. I mean, you have all kinds of strange thoughts. And what we find is a big chunk of wood, maybe a foot long and a few inches thick. It was heavy. Both ends, though, had the same twirled strands like the trees that we had seen up on the hill that afternoon. While we're looking at that piece of wood, we hear something moving on the hill. You can hear all the snaps and the noise of branches moving out there in the darkness. He turns around, hits the spotlight, and lit up the hill again. But the trees there were so thick, we couldn't see into where the sound was. The piece of wood had left a very nice dent in the metal side of the trailer wall, and my boyfriend was not happy about that. He told me to go on inside. He was going to find out who it was out there. And he was going to let them know they need to leave his land. So, now we'd moved from an animal being out there to a human. Because as he said, there's nothing out there in those woods that can throw things at people. When he said he was going out there, I said, "Are you crazy? It's pitch black out there." I think he caught my meaning. Human or not, it's just not a good idea to walk into the woods at night after someone or something, when they just threw a chunk of wood at you like that, even if you did have a firearm with you. So he turned around and he started to yell that whoever it was had best get off his land. He was armed, and he did not take kindly to trespassers. We waited a few minutes, and no reply came and nothing happened. Giving up, we decided to go in, but before we did, my boyfriend took that chunk of wood that had been thrown at the trailer, and he threw it on a very high arc deep into the trees on the hillside. We turned to go inside. I had my hand just on the back door when a howl from the hill behind us started up. My skin crawled. I had never heard anything like it. It sounded like an eerie siren of some kind had started up there on the hill. I said, "What is that?" I noticed he had also stopped and was listening. He said he didn't know what it was. Again, he turned the spotlight on and panned around, but again, it just lit up all the leaves on the trees where they started up the hill, and the howl came from much further up that hill. We both stood there and listened for a few more seconds until he finally said, "I don't know what it is, but I think our night out here is over." We went inside and went to bed, but neither of us could get to sleep. And the strangest thing happened that night. It may be unrelated, but a bunch of dogs came from somewhere, and they were running up there on that hill. They were not coyotes, and we didn't have dogs. And I didn't know anyone up and down that road that had any dogs that they would ever let roam loose like that. And it was a big pack of dogs. You could hear them. It was more like a pack of hunting dogs, but it wasn't hunting season. And nobody let those dogs loose at night. And it sounded like they had followed something and they had cornered it up on the hill. It sounded like there was a fight. The whole thing was loud enough that both me and him got up out of bed and were looking out the window. He put his boots on, grabbed his rifle and the spotlight, and went out and stood on the back porch and ran the spotlight up that hill again. He really was thinking there's somebody up there. Then the howl came again, but it was different this time, very different than what we'd heard earlier. Earlier, it was more of a long, lazy, drawn-out siren sound. Now, it was like hearing a shrieking howl, and whatever it was pissed off. As soon as that howl started, the dog stopped. When the howl stopped, there were no more dog sounds. In fact, we didn't hear another sound at all night. It was the strangest thing, and I still don't know what to make of that. I'm not sure how long, but one afternoon, sometime after all of that happened, I was outside mounding up all the dirt on the potatoes. I was busy doing that, and I wasn't paying any attention to anything around me. The garden was a strip of tilled dirt, and it was a bit away from the trailer, but it got south full sun all day. But that also meant it was out near where the trees started up the hill. So I'm out there, and all of a sudden, my boyfriend comes running and yelling, and I freak out because I see he's got his rifle. I swear it looked like he was running right for me. I froze, and he ran right past me, and he didn't stop when he hit the trees. The whole time, he's screeching like a banshee. These weren't yells. I mean, he was screeching, and I couldn't understand half of what he was screaming about. I was still standing there in shock looking after him when he came running back out of the trees just a few seconds later. He grabbed me, threw my shovel down, and forcefully dragged me into the house. He had never acted like that. I was so shocked I couldn't argue. Finally, when we were inside, I asked him what the heck was going on. I had never seen him act like that. He really was the proverbial laid-back, nothing-ever-bothered-him kind of country boy, until then. Then he looks at me and he says, "Didn't you see it? Didn't you see it staring at you?" I had no idea what he was referring to. The best I could guess was there was a bear. So I said, "No, I didn't see a bear." He looked at me and he said, "You thought it was a bear?" He asked me that question like I had to be the dumbest person on earth. I said, "I didn't think it was anything because I didn't see anything. What did you see out there?" I was really getting freaked out now because he was freaked out. The whole time we're having this talk, he kept looking out the window over the sink that looked out back. Then he said, "Baby, listen, I'll tell you what I saw, but you ain't going to believe it." I said, "What? Tell me." Then he says, "Either that was the biggest darn black bear I've ever seen standing on its back legs, or that was a Bigfoot out there, and I sure know there ain't a bear that big in all of Tennessee." I'm looking at him and I'm trying to process what he's saying. A Bigfoot? What is he talking about? I said, "Whoa, tell me what happened." He said he was rinsing his cup out at the sink when he looked up, and he saw me out there in the garden. Then he immediately saw something very large standing near the trees that were behind my back. He said he could tell it was trying not to be seen, and he could tell it was staring at me. That's when he grabbed his rifle and headed out the door. When it saw and heard him come out, it turned and started quickly walking away up the hill. When he went in there after it up the hill, he said it was going up that hill twice as fast as him. When he got a few steps into those trees, he said he was bringing his rifle up. He was going to shoot it. But it turned around. It turned around and it looked at him and it growled. He said he was looking right into the eyes of it, and he could not bring his rifle up to shoot it. He said it was the strangest thing. It was a shocking moment, and he felt like he was looking at another human, a human who just had fur on his face. I said, "What do you mean, Tell me what it looked like exactly. I asked because I still wasn't on board with believing he saw a Bigfoot. He said, I'm telling you, it's the biggest thing I've ever seen that was not in a zoo. That thing could have swatted me down like I was a tiny gnat. I looked at him to see if he was being for real, because he was a really big guy himself, but I could see that he was. Then he said, It looked right at me. I tell you, I saw its eyes. Its head was domed, and it had a wide face and huge jaws. It was standing up on two legs. It had shoulders as wide as two of me. I know it stood every bit of 8 feet tall. He was looking out the window as he's telling me this. Then he said, When it turned and looked me in the eye, I thought I was going to die right there. He looked at me, and I knew he was telling the truth. I had never known him to turn tail and run from anything. So whatever he had seen, it was real. After a while, he got himself together, and later we went out and finished what needed to be done in the garden before it got too far down in the afternoon. He said he didn't want me out there alone anymore. He said he did not like the way it had been looking at me. By then, I decided it was time to lighten the mood, and I was trying to make a joke about things. I said, What do you mean? You think he liked me? And I winked at him and tried to laugh. He did not laugh. Deadpan, he said, It looked like it wanted to cover me in ketchup and eat me. I didn't smile anymore. I sure did not like the way that sounded. And I said, How do you know that's what it wanted to do? He said he didn't know, but it was the feeling he got when he looked at it. At that time, the only thing I knew about the internet was AOL. There wasn't much Bigfoot related on AOL itself. Then someone showed me how to use something called Netscape, and then we found all kinds of things on Bigfoot. I know that sounds funny today, but back then, I really didn't know there was anything outside of AOL. I thought AOL was the internet. When we found still pictures from the one video that everyone has seen, he looked at it and he said, The one he saw was kind of like that. And his words were, But it was taller and wider. And either we didn't find any howling sounds on the internet, or we couldn't download them at that time because of our terrible internet connection by phone. I don't remember which, but I do know we didn't find any sounds at that time that we could compare what we had heard to. And lots of times the rest of that summer, there were weird things that we heard and weird things that happened. And we didn't sit out much around the fire pit out back anymore. And I could only garden when he was home and had his rifle out there with us. That's the only way either of us felt safe about it. Some of the weird things that we found were rocks and pieces of wood all around the trailer. We would find them when we would get home from work. They weren't there when we left, and they were in very obvious places. They were odd piles or places you couldn't help but notice them. And our garden itself was ransacked several times that year. I finally gave up and let go of it. So much for canning and putting up anything that year. We heard the howling and other sounds, things we didn't know how to identify. I don't know if they were all one and the same, but I rather think they were. He said it was the only time he'd ever heard any of those things, and he'd lived there for several years. He did see it again, one more time. It was one morning when he was going to work. Like any other morning, he got in his truck, started it, and put it in reverse and began to back into the side gravel area so he could then point nose out and go down the drive. When his back reverse lights came on and he started to back up, he said he looked behind him in the window to swing into that turnaround area, and he stopped and slammed on the brakes. It was a Bigfoot, maybe 10 or 15 feet behind the truck. He hit the brakes, and then a couple seconds passed where he just looked at it. He said it stood there, looking sideways at him and the truck. Then, very slowly, it walked across the rest of the gravel, down the grass, and across the wash-off ditch that led over to the trees. The thought hit him then that it might have been out there the whole time while he was getting into the truck. And more disturbingly, he was afraid it might have been out there when I left for work not long before him that morning. Never again did I go out to that car in darkness, unescorted by him. But we'd never thought they would come up by the house. In all the reading we had done, we thought they would stay in the woods. Everything we read had said they stayed in the woods. At least we had gotten that idea somehow. That was the last time that he saw one that I'm aware of. We are sure we heard it many more times, and while hunting that fall, we did find a lot of broken trees, more of them, up by the ridge line. Well, I say broken, but they were twisted, just like we'd found that summer. For what it's worth, I believe he really did see a Bigfoot. He knows what bears are. He grew up in the whole Smoky Mountains area. He was your typical country boy who didn't have an imagination. And that's not an insult when I say that, by the way. I just mean he had no reason to make things up. It just wasn't something he did. By winter, there was nothing else happening. And all the rest of the time that I lived there, just over another year, we had no more incidents or sightings. I guess it moved on. I know I've forgotten lots after all this time. I think about it, and it's all like a blur now. Sometimes I wonder, did it all really happen? And then I think to myself, oh, yes, it did, Angela. It happened all right. I've always wished that I had seen it, too, just to know that I could have. He said it was better that I didn't see it. I have often wondered, how many times had I been out there that summer before we knew anything was going on? You know, when I was just feeling uncomfortable out there on the hillside. How many times was I out there alone, maybe doing some gardening, or just sitting in one of those chairs in the sun reading my book like I used to do? How many times was it watching me from the trees? I now live back in Indiana. I live where it's so flat and treeless, I can see for miles all around our house. I'm surrounded by farmland, no trees anywhere, and I like that just fine. As far as I last knew, he is still living there out on Dripping Springs Road in Seymour, Tennessee. Who knows? Maybe he'll hear this, and maybe he'll send in his side of things. Thanks a lot, Angela. Now, many of you might remember Anson from Willow Creek, California. Anson has written in many times and details for us that he and his family have been interacting with a family of Bigfoot for a while out here. Here is Anson's latest email. Greetings and hello to you, Nance and the Sasquad. I do hope that you and the squad had a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. Things have been rather chaotic here in California for the past few weeks since New Year's Eve weekend, what with all the storms that have hit us. In the Mammoth area alone, they received over 34 feet of snow in a 10-day period. Seeing that there's a 10-day period of sunshine until the next round of storms hit, myself and the whole family, including the naysayer John, went up to our grandparents' house in Willow Creek to check on the storm damage and to check up on how Clarence's family was doing. When we got there, we found the house buried under 20 feet of snow. It has taken the better part of the last 2 days to clear out the snow. Rob, my brother-in-law, and myself went out to look for Clarence's family to see how they were doing. We found them holed up in a cave not far from the house with all of them suffering from bad colds and chest congestion. We called for Harvey and Hulk to come out. It took them a few minutes to come out, and boy, were they happy to see us. Rob and I talked to both of them, and we told Harvey and Hulk to round up everyone and head back to our house so we could take care of them. It took a few minutes for them to understand that, but they finally called back into the cave and got everyone out. Both of us were surprised to find out that Bam Bam and Harvey's new mates were pregnant, and by the looks of it, they will be having little feet in the next few months. When we got back to the house, everyone was glad and happy to see that Clarence's family was still with us, all except the naysayer John, who went back inside. Rob and I got a fire going in the guest house to warm them up, with Ashley and Howard starting to give them antibiotics to help with the congestion. Meanwhile, Kate and Sue started on a big pot of chicken soup for them. Rob and I started up the barbecue grill to cook steaks and baked potatoes for everyone. When I went out to the woodshed for charcoal and more wood for the grill and fireplace, I caught movement out the corner of my eye and went to check it out. I ran into Clarence's brother, Alfalfa, who I've not seen in nearly 25 years. The reason we call Clarence's brother Alfalfa is due to the fact that he has a cowlick at the back of his head, just like Alfalfa from The Little Rascals. Alfalfa and his family live up near Mount Shasta, nearly 73 miles to the northeast from Willow Creek. Clarence's family was whooping and hooting with joy. Well, Nance, got to go now. Got plenty of work to be done before the next storm hits us. Got to go fill up all the feeders for the wildlife near our home. Until next time, Nance and squad, be safe. Anson. This comment was left on Tuesday's video, and here's what they had to say. Had an encounter in Georgia across the creek where I was also hunting, and heard a very powerful roar that sounded like a T-Rex. And after I got my nerve up and went to the location, I saw two trees freshly broken across the road. Then after recording the brakes and as I was walking towards my ATV, I heard some thundering footsteps running away from me. Whatever it was, it had to have been at least 15 feet from me. I've been noticing silence over there when I crossed the creek since the early 90s, but never heard a sound, but felt like something was watching me. That stopped me from hunting there for good. Next, we have an email from a woman who calls herself Brush Creek. She has sent in some other emails, which I will link in the video description below. After her email, more than a few of you in the comments opened her eyes to the possibility of it being something other than Bigfoot. And it has changed her life, her outlook, and how she feels about where she lives. Here's the email she sent. Hi, Nance. I'm not sure this is an email you will choose to use on your show, as it's not exactly a story. It's more of how I feel after the last email I sent in, and the comments about the Gugway. I am literally living in fear now, a fear I did not have until it was placed in my face in a manner I was not able to ignore and just go about my life here on the farm. I like to think of myself as a brave person, and one that doesn't allow anyone or anything to live in my head rent-free. In other words, I don't let anybody control me. But this does. From the second I typed that word into my Google search, I have been terrified. I feel like at any moment, that thing is going to pop out from behind every possible hiding place and just snatch me up. Leaving my house in the dark was something that never used to bother me, but it absolutely is not going to happen now. I don't open curtains at all now. Doors have added locks, and things as simple as a walk to the mailbox no longer happen. I can't. I just can't force myself to walk that far away from the little comfort that my sticks and bricks gives me. We are in peak kidding and lambing season here on the homestead. My twice nightly trips to the barn that I used to make on my own, carrying nothing more than a flashlight in winters past, are now only done when I have my husband to accompany me, and we are both packing heat. The fear I feel on what should be my place of peace is crippling. Every noise, every bump or bang, and instantly I almost faint in fear. We can't sell the place. It's been in his family for several generations. And honestly, trying to buy land in today's market is ridiculously high, and in most cases, an unreachable goal. Short of selling every animal on the place and using that money to buy land, I don't know what to do. And doing that would just completely destroy the whole purpose of why we are homesteading in the first place. I don't know exactly what these things are, but I know this much. If I'm going to stay on a place I have come to love so much and not live in constant fear, they have to go, period, by any means necessary. I fear for my children, I fear for my husband, and I fear for myself. The stress of it all makes me physically ill. I love your channel and the support and love that you and your followers provide. But if I could go back to having never emailed in the first place, I would. Only because it made it too real. I know that sounds crazy. I know they are real. But before, they were just what they were, the not-so-friendly friends that lived in our woods a few months out of the year. Now they are monsters and a debilitating threat that causes me to almost not be able to function in everyday life here. I know I'm just kind of rambling on at this point. I truly appreciate you having a safe space that people like us can come to and hear what others go through and not feel like we are alone in the struggle of it. Much love to you all and to Miss Sage. Signed, Brush Creek. All right, well, thank you to everyone for hanging with me to the very end of this long journey tonight. I've enjoyed it, and I hope you enjoy it as well. Now, if you've missed Anson's or Brush Creek's other emails, as I mentioned, I'll put links to them in the video description below. You know, I'm always surprised at the number of emails that I get from people who have actually emailed in before. I want to say a special thank you to everyone who did send something in. And if you have an encounter that you'd like to share on this channel, don't hesitate. Send it to me at contact@BuckeyeBigfoot.com. All right. Well, as you know, we have Valentine's Day just around the corner. So now's the right time to make sure you're smelling all squeaky, clean, and sweet for your Valentine. And there's no better way to do that than to order yourself some Yeti Bar soaps. So go to www.yetibars.net and use code BB10 to get 10% off their soaps, which are already on sale. That's right. You can combine that code with their Valentine's Day discounts, and you can get yourself 15 to 20% off. It's definitely worth it. So go on over to yetibars.net. All right, now let's see. I'm still collecting some questions for the Q&A video I'm hoping to do soon. I've gotten a few, but not enough for a whole video. So if you've got any questions out there that you want to ask me, send it to me at contact@BuckeyeBigfoot.com and I'll add it to the list. And hopefully by then, my voice will be much stronger than it is today. All right. Well, I think that's going to round out our journey down into Sasquatch Valley for tonight. You know, sometimes I do miss saying that. I can't lie. I miss the hoarse clippy-clop sounds. But I also like the simpler upfront format that we're going to right now. I don't know. I'll have to think about this. And you know, I'll be thinking about all this till we meet up again. And until we do, always remember, absence of proof is not proof of absence. Thanks for listening, everyone.